On day three. So just to recapitulate what we discussed yesterday, we discussed about expressions. So as you know, expressions, they are made up of operands. A simple operand can make an expression, but those expressions, they are not meaningful, they are not computing anything. So our purpose is to use expressions to compute values, to do certain computations. So we mix operands with operators, and the operator and operand together form expressions which are meaningful expressions which are doing certain computations. For example, this a plus 4 into max function call is an expression. Then we discussed that expressions, they are broadly classified into simple expressions and compound expressions. Simple expressions are those expressions in which there is involvement of only one operator, and compound expressions are those expressions in which more than one operator is involved. So as there is only one operator involved in simple expression, the evaluation does not create any problem. We are clear that how this evaluation is to be carried out, because one operator is there, it has to operate. But in compound expressions, when there are more than one operator involved, then we have to figure out that which of the operator is to be operated first, or which of the evaluation is to be carried out first. For example, in this expression 2 plus 3 exponent 2, we have to figure out whether plus is to be carried out first, or whether exponent or the power is to be carried out first, because that gives different output. So here is when the precedence of the operators come to the picture. The operators which are having higher precedence will get operated first, and the operators which are lower in precedence, they will be operated as per their precedence chart. So sometimes it also happens that in a compound expression, operators of the same precedence are involved. Then again, there is an issue that how to evaluate those operators. For example, in 2 exponent 3 exponent 4, whether we have to carry out 2 exponent 3 first, or whether we have to carry out 3 exponent 4 first, that is an issue, because both exponent operators are involved. Here is when we look for what is the associativity of the operators. Operators of the same precedence have the same associativity. Either left to right or right to left. For example, this power operator exponent operator, it is right to left, or 3 exponent 4 is out, and then the result is used for carrying out 2 exponent, whatever the result comes. So associativity also plays an important role. Then we look for how we have to classify operators. We classified operators on two categories. What are the number of operands it operates upon, or what is its role? Depending upon how or the number of operands it operates upon, we categorized into three categories. Unary operators, those operators which work only on one operand, like unary minus, unary plus, logical not, and binary operators which work on two operands. They expect an operand on their left and they expect an operand on their right also. So ternary operators which work on three operands, like there is a conditional operator C which is question mark colon. Similarly, there is a conditional operator in Python also, which was introduced in Python version 2.5, that is if else. So this is the ternary operator which is available in Python. Depending upon their role, we have discussed that these operators, they can be classified into categories like arithmetic operators, comparison operators, logical operators, bitwise operators, and miscellaneous operators. Arithmetic operators we discussed yesterday. Operator plus, unary minus, subtraction. These are the operators that we have already discussed yesterday, but I'll briefly explain how and what are the rules to use these operators. So first of all, you must know that if the parenthesization is involved, parenthesization overrides the precedence rule and the parenthesized sub-expression is evaluated first. And if there is string of the parenthesis, the innermost parenthesized expression will get evaluated first. And there is a typecasting or automatic type conversion which is applicable. So if the operand involved is of complex type, the other operand gets converted to complex type. Then if it is not of complex type but of floating point type, then other operand gets converted to floating point type. If they are integer, then it is okay, no conversion is carried out. So then we have discussed few rules. Cell is 2 power bc. So I just want to reemphasize that operands of power operator must be of numeric type. That means that they can be integer, floating point numbers or complex numbers. They cannot be sequences, that they cannot be string or any other, right? So this, if you execute this 2 exponent bc, this is going to give you type error. Then we have discussed that if the second operand of the exponent operator or the power operator is negative, the result is going to be a floating point number. So if you do 10 exponent minus 2, this is going to be 0.01, is a floating point number. Then we have discussed that if second operand is negative like this, but the first operand is 0, then it is going to give 0 division error, which is an exception. And later in the course, you will learn about how to handle exceptions. Then we have discussed that if the first operand is 0 and other operand is a non-negative number, then it is going to give 0 always. So 0 exponent 2 is 0 and 0 exponent 200 is even 0. And then we have seen that if the first operand, but the second operand is 0, then you are going to get always 1. Then we have learned about one of the important rule about binding of the power operator. And we have discussed that if there is unary operator involved on the left side of the power operator binds more tightly than the unary operator on its left. But it binds less tightly than unary operator on its right. So if minus 10 exponent 2 is given, then this would be interpreted as minus 10 exponent 2 within brackets. So this would be interpreted in this way. Reason being is that exponent operator binds more tightly than this unary minus. So this comes up, would not have been done if minus binds more tightly. I am reiterating, the power operator binds more tightly than unary operator on its left. But if it would not have happened, so the result of this expression would have came out to be minus 0.01, because this would have become minus 1 upon 100 and that would have become minus 0.01. So that is not the case. So that's why this comes out to be, I'm expecting this comes out to be minus 100. So this indicates that power operator binds more tightly than unary operator on its left. But it binds less tightly than the unary operator on its right. So this we have already discussed, that we have discussed that if there is a negative number as first operand and the second operand comes out to be a fraction or a floating point number, so the result of the power operator will come out to be a complex number. Then we have discussed that if both the operands are of complex number type, the result will come out to be of complex number. Then we have discussed about unary plus operator, which is a dummy operator, doesn't do anything, but sometimes you use it. And unary minus operator, you have seen it negates value already seen. It can is overloaded operator. It can work on numeric types. It can also work on sequences. If you are applying multiplication operator on sequences, then one of the operand must be integer and the second operand must be a sequence. So when it is applied on sequences, it results in repeated sequences. Now I want everyone to take an indication from this and tell me that if I want to produce or if I want to make a tuple of 10 ones, how can I do that without writing 10 ones in the tuple? I am repeating the question. I want to produce a tuple. I want to produce a tuple of 10 ones, but I do not want to type 10 ones like this. I do not want to do it. How can I work with this operator? Yes, Sarthak, if you make a tuple of 1 and you multiply it with 10, so it will result in tuple of 10 ones like this, whatever is on the screen. So it can result in repeated sequences. We have also discussed that if you multiply it with 0, it results in empty sequence, or a negative number, it results in empty sequence. We have discussed division operator and division operator. Important rule that I want to emphasize is that the result of sign of evaluation of division operator depends upon what is the sign of numerator or operand 1 and what sign of denominator that is operand 2. The result sign of the result is determined. This we have already covered. Then we have discussed with the modulus operator. Modulus operator gives you the remainder, and the sign of the result of the evaluation of the modulus operator depends upon sign of second operand only. Unlike division operator, where sign depends upon both the operands, here in case of modulus operator, the sign depends upon the sign of the second operand only. This we have already discussed. Modulus operator is again overloaded operator. It can be used with strings as a string formatting operator. So if you give this, here is the usage of the modulus operator. Here is the usage of modulus operator. So this is used for string formatting. Addition and subtraction operator, they are overloaded operators. They can be used for numeric computation. They produce addition and subtraction, and the addition operator can also be applied on sequence. So when addition operator is applied on sequence except range, it results in concatenation of the sequences, concatenation. So this we have already discussed in the yesterday's session. Today we look for another category of operators. Those are known as comparison operators. These operators are used to compare two objects. And we have three categories of operators. This comparison category. Firstly, the comparison operators can be less than equal to, greater than equal to, not equal to, and equality operator. And we have membership operator, that is in, and we have identity test operator, that is. We also discussed yesterday one of the important concept about token, which says that token is a single unit. So if I am writing operator, say less than equal to, or if I am putting operator equal to, then this is to be treated as a single unit. This is a unit. So once it is to be treated as a token, once it is unit, don't ever try to put space between these two. Don't try to put space here. Don't try to do that. If you do that, this will not be treated as one token. This will be treated as one token, and this will be treated as another token, and this becomes less than, and this becomes assignment, which is not an operator in Python. which is a statement. So then you must be sure about where you can put spaces and where you cannot. Don't ever try to put white space characters in between the tokens, which split the token. Token is to be taken as unit. So very first that you must know is that they are tokens, and if there are two characters in a token, you are not going to put any white space character in it. So they are always going to give Boolean constant. So their result is always Boolean constant. So if you put A is less than B, where A is having value 2 and B is having value 3, so this is going to give you true, which is a Boolean constant. So the result of evaluation of comparison operator is just value of its operands, and they can be of numeric different numeric types. And arithmetic type conversion is applied to convert them to the common type. The second rule is that if the operands they are of different type, the equality operator always returns false and inequality operator always returns true, irrespective of the elements of the type. And the order comparison operator cannot have operands of different types. So look at this case, the code cell 1. On the left, we have on the left side of the equality operator, the operand 1 is the tuple. The elements of the tuple are 1 and 2. And on the right side, there is a list. Elements of both the objects which are given as operand to equality operator, they are the same. But if I execute it, it is going to give me false because they are of different types. So when the equality operator is applied, if the operands are of different type, equality operator is always going to give false. Now in the second question, on the left side I have a set 1 and 2. On the right side I have a dictionary, and if I apply not equal to operator on it, it is going to give me true. Although the elements, the values are different, but it is saying that it is not equal, not just by the comparison, but because they are of different types. So when different types are given to not equal, so it will always say true. When one is tuple and second is less than, and you apply, you are going to get type error. Reason being is type error comes here because of this rule, which says that comparison operators less than equal to cannot have operands of different types. You cannot give operands which are of different type to comparison operators. They can be given to equality operator and not equal to operator, but for comparison operators, they must be of the same type. Second thing is when the operands of the same type are given as comparison operator, they perform the lexicographic comparison. They perform the lexicographic for less than operator. We have given first operand as string and second operand as string. So both of them are of same type. Now the comparison will be done one by one. So A is compared to small a, okay, and you know that the code for this capital A is 65 and that for this small a is 97. So when it is done, this comes out to be true. So there is no need to compare rest of the elements. So this comes out to be, this comes out to be true. But suppose first character here is A, then next is B, next is also B, and next, now what would be the output in this case is compared out to be equal. So the next is compared out to be equal, and C is to be compared. Smaller C is having higher code, capital C. So if I do that, what would be the output? But what would be the output in this case? So if I do that, it comes out to be false. Reason being is C is 99. And when we compare this, this is C. When hi and hello are compared, H and H, they are the same. When I is compared with E, I comes later to E. So is it less? It will give you false. It is not less. It is giving you false. Similarly, when byte, in this case, both of them are bytes. So byte high is compared with byte low, it gives false. Can anybody tell me what is the result of this code cell which I have highlighted now? Quickly. So now I have equality operator. Now I have equality operator, but remember the rule why it is false. Yes, true, it will come out to be false, but why it is false? Because one of the operand is of string type and another operand of byte type. Yes, so it will not perform the comparison. It will just look what are the types. So types are different, so it will say it when the sequences like tuples and the list, they are given to the comparison operators, so they are compared graphically one by one. So like in this example, when this tuple of list, what is the operand on the left side of the operator? This is a tuple, but what is the elements of the tuple? They are the lists. So this is a tuple of lists of integer. Are you getting my point? This is a tuple. Tuple is of lists, and list is of integers. So this is a tuple of list of integers, and it is compared with tuple of list of integers, right? So now both the operands, they are of the same type. So when comparison is done, first element is compared with the first element of the second. So they are the list. Now the when list is to be compared again, its first element is compared with the first element of the second. So one and one, they compare equal, but three and two, they do not compare equal. So three is greater than two, so the comparison comes up to be false, and the rest of the elements, they will not be compared. This three and this two results in the conclusion. The comparison of this three and this two helps us in concluding that the first operand is not less than the second operand. This is how comparison is done lexicographically, element by element, element by element. When dictionaries are compared, dictionary compare equal when they have same key value pair. So when they have same key value pair, dictionaries compare equal. Since dictionaries are unordered, the ordering of the key and the value does not matter. So for example, K1 and L2 and K1, they compare equal. Look at this case. So K1 and 1, 2 and L2 and K1, they compare equal. The ordering of the keys and the values is insignificant. It does not matter. The only thing that matters is that the keys must be the same and their values must be the same. So order comparison operators cannot have operands of dictionary type and results in type error. So if we apply on this, this is order comparison operator. So order comparison operator, we have seen less than equal to, greater than equal to, they are order comparison operators. So these operators cannot have operands of your dictionary type. And if you give operand of dictionary type to order comparison operators are less than equal to, greater than equal to, so they result in type error. So when operands, they are of set types, set type, now two set compares equal if they have the same element. Remember, sets, they are unordered elements. So sets, they are unordered elements. So one of the operand is set 1, 2 and 3. Another operand is again set 3, 2 and 1. They are having same elements, but ordering is different. So when I compute this, so this gives me true, because the elements are the same and set being unordered, their ordering does not matter. So 1, 2 and 3 less than equal to, which is the order comparison operator, tells us whether set is a subset or a proper subset of other operator. So in this case, if I am writing it 1, 2, 3 less than equal to, this means that whether operand 1 is a subset of operand 2. Whether operand 1 is subset of operand 2. That means whether element of operand 1 is present in set 2 or not, operand 2 or not. So 1, 2 and 3, 1, 2 and 3 are present here. So if I result, if I compute it, it comes out to be true. So if I remove 3 from here, now whether the elements of set 1, are they present in the set 2? Now 3 is not present in set 2, so it will give me false. It will give me false. So order comparison operator less than equal to, when applied on sets, checks whether operand 1 is subset of operand 2 or not. Order comparison operator less than, when applied on sets, check whether it is proper subset of the second operand or not. And the difference between set and proper subset is, now in this case, operand 1 must be having one element. Operand 2 must be having one element which is not present in operand 1. So operand 2 must have at least one element more than that in operand 1. So if I do that, it says false. Because in operand 1, I have 1, 2, 3. All the elements are present in the second operand. It is not proper subset. So if I make 4 here, now 4 is the one element which is not present in operand 1. That's why operand 1 is proper of similar. When greater than equal to is used, it looks for superset, and when greater is used, it looks for proper superset. So order comparison operators, when applied on sets, they look for whether they are subset, proper subset or superset or proper subset or not. So this 1, 2, 3, what I expect for this, this will give me true, because 3 is there. 3 is there. If I look for this, if I look for this, what will be the result for these students? Just give true or false in the chat box. ABC greater than, that means whether it is proper, is present and B is not present in this set. If I run it, it will give me true. Can you tell me what will be the output of this ABC and CA? So output of this comes out to be false. Remember, ABC is not same as A comma B comma C. So this is tuple of string, and the first element of the tuple is ABC, and the first element of this is CA. So it is not true. It comes out to be false. So am I clear? Am I clear till now? If you can put yes or no on the chat box, then we will proceed with the membership test operator. So in Python there is, so in the membership test operator, it checks whether operand 1 is in operand 2 or not. So the first operand of the operator should be a value, and the second operand must be a sequence, set or dictionary type. So these are the constraints on it. So in the membership operator, the first must be a value and second must be sequence, set or dictionary type. So look at it. If I results in HI, it looks whether HI is there in this or not. So since it is there, so it returns true. So it the first rule is that if the second operand is a string or byte object, the operator returns true if the first operand is substring of the second operand. Since HI is substring of Hindi, so that's why it returns true. Second rule says that if the second operand of the operator is a dictionary, the operator tests whether the first operand appears as a key within the dictionary. Now look at this rule and this question. So K in K2, now it looks for whether K appear as key in the dictionary. Since it is appearing as key in the dictionary, it returns true. Students, you tell me what will be the output for this highlighted cell. I am checking whether K in LK, L is the key, K is the value, false. Reason being is K is the value, it is not the key. And the in operator, second operand is dictionary, it checks whether the first operand appear as key in the dictionary or not. That's why it is giving false. If the second operand is a tuple, whether the first operand appear with the second operand or not. It returns true, otherwise it returns false. So like in this case, 1 2 is tuple, and the second operand of in operator, can you tell me what second operand of the in operator? It is tuple of, is list of tuples. Second operator of tuples. So it checks, yes, we appears in the second operand or not. So 1 2 appears in it, so it will give true. So is the membership operator clear? So the next operator is the identity test operator. The next operator is identity test operator, IS, is. So you know, students, what is identity? Identity is the location, is the address where your data object is present. So this is operator returns view if both operands refer to the same object. Remember our first day, I told you identifier is a label, identifier is a way to refer to data object. So if both the operands refer to the same data object, then we will get true. If the operands, they refer to different data objects, we will get false. Now look at this case. A is equal to 10. Semicolon you can put if you want to execute more than one statement in single line. If you want to put more than one statement in single line, you can put semicolon. So A is equal to 10, B is equal to 10 statements we are executing in single line. So that's why we have placed semicolon. Then we have said A is equal to B is equal to C. Okay. So this is the chaining of equality operator. This is the chaining of equality operator. Unlike other programming languages like C, Python allows you to chain these operators. And when these are chained, so this will be interpreted as, this will be interpreted as A is equal to B and logical AND is used. B is equal to C and B is equal to C. So A is 10, B is 10 and C is 10. So A is equal to B is true and B is equal to C is also true. What would be the outcome of 1 less than 2 less than 3? So 1 less than 2 less than 3 comes up to be true. Reason being A, this would be interpreted as 1 is less than 2 and 2 is less than 3, both of them are true. 1 is less than 2 and 2 is less than 3, both of them are true. For AND operator to evaluate true, both of the operands must be true. That's why this comes out to be true. 1 is less than 5 is greater than 3. So this could be interpreted as 1 is less than 5 and 5 greater than 3, 5 greater than 3. So 1 less than 5 is true. 1 less than 5 is true. 5 greater than 3 is true. So if I do that, so this gives me true. Then this would be interpreted as, how will this interpret it? Look at it. Membership test operator is chained. Membership test operator is chained. So it will be interpreted as 1 in 1, 2, 1 in 1, 2, and 1, 2, 1, 2, which is a list in 1, 2, and 2, 3. So this will be interpreted like this. Since 1 is there in 1, 2, and 1, 2 is there in 1, 2, 2, 3, so both of them are coming out to be true. Now we have to discuss the identity test operator. Identity test operator. Suppose I do A is equal to 10 and B is equal to A. B is equal to A. So what I have done, students, I have made a data object. A is equal to 10. So what I have done, I have made 10 and I have made it to refer to by A. It comes somewhere at memory 1 2 3 4 5 6. Then I have done B is equal to A, so B is also referring to the same data object. So when I check A is B, that means I am checking whether both of the operands, they are having same identity or not. So it is saying me true. Or this is other way to check. This is equivalent to writing. This is equivalent to writing if identity of A is equal to identity of B. So if identity of A is equal to identity of B, I am checking, I am getting that both of them refer to the same data object. That's why it is coming out to be true. So this is identity test operator. Okay, it checks for the identity. So now what we are doing, A is 10, A is, you are picking 10, you are assigning it A, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now B is equal to C is equal to A. So in this case, both A, B and C, they refer to the same place. Now we are checking A is B. So this will be equal to A is B and B is C, B is C. So that is returned. So what is the outcome? Outcome you know. So if I run this code, so this says true. Reason being is because all A, B and C, they refer to the same location, same data object. That's why all of them are having same identity. So this is all about comparison operators. So if you have any doubt about comparison operators, let me know. Otherwise, we'll move ahead with the logical operators. If you have any doubt about comparison operators, the comparison operator consists of membership test operator and identity test operator. So if there is no doubt, then we are moving to the next category, which is known as logical operators. So the logical operators, they are used to logically relate the sub-operators which are available in Python are not and or. Remember, they have different operator now as compared to C language. In C language, for not, we were using or in C language, but now or. So they are just strings, and remember that strings are in lowercase. So not should be in lowercase, or should be in lowercase, and should be in lowercase. Okay. So they operate according to truth table, and you know the truth table of all these operations. For and to come out to be true, both of the operands must be true. For or to come out to be true, any of the operand can be true. For not, if you give false, operand as false, not is unary operator, it operates only on one operand. If you give false, it results in true. If you give true, it results in false. So according to these, they are evaluated. Now there are important rules regarding the evaluation. So if the operand of logical operator is false, none, or zero value or empty value, it will be considered as false. Remember, what will be taken as false? False, which is a Boolean constant, none, zero or empty values, they will be taken as false. Other values will be considered as true. And logical and logical or, they are evaluated left to right. And expressions, they are evaluated and the output of the expression is determined. Okay. So let's come to this first point. ABC and this is, tell me what this is. What is the data type of empty braces? Tell me on the chat box quickly. Yes, this is dictionary, empty dictionary, and the rule says that the empty values, they are considered as false. So if I do this, this is going to give me empty dictionary. So this is going, look at the rule. This is the rule. If E1 and E2 are expressions which are operands, then even is evaluated first. If E2 evaluates to false, it is not evaluated. But if even evaluates to true, it to be evaluated to determine the truthfulness of the expression, and the result will be as the result of evaluation of E2. This is important, very important point. Result of evaluation of overall expression will be the result of evaluation of E2. So ABC is evaluated, this comes out to true. Since true and true can be true and false can be false, so the result is not yet attained, so we have to evaluate this. Now this is evaluated, empty dictionary comes out to be false, and the result of the overall expression comes out to be same as the result of this expression, so this comes out to be empty bracket. So am I clear in my specification of the rule? If we evaluate ABC and CD, firstly ABC will be evaluated, which comes out to be true, which comes out to be true. Since true and second thing can be true or false, so I need to evaluate this CD. Our result of the evaluation comes out to be the result of the second expression, so it would be same as CD. So what would be the result of this? What would be the result of this? First is evaluated, first comes out to be empty tuple, so this comes out to be false. So once this comes out to be false, this 1, 2, 3 will not be evaluated, and the result will come out to be false, which is empty tuple. Similarly in OR, look for what is the rule that is applicable. Even or E2, where even and E2 are sub expressions, even and E2 are sub expressions. Even is evaluated first. If it evaluates to true, there is no need to evaluate the second operand. The second operand, the first evaluates to true, with the result of evaluation of even. But if even evaluates to false, it too will be evaluated to determine the truthfulness of the expression, and the result will be same as the result of evaluation of E2. So look at it. This comes out to be true. ABC. This comes out to be true. ABC is true. Again, yes, Tanish, look at it. ABC evaluates to true, because non-zero values, non-zero sequences, they evaluate to true. If first evaluates to true and the operator is AND, we have to evaluate second operand to check whether overall expression evaluates to true or false. And C evaluates to true. So the overall expression is true, and the result will be same as the result of evaluation of second operand. So second operand is CD. So this will come out to be CD. Am I clear, Tanishk? So look at this question again. ABC or empty dictionary. So first is true, there is no need to evaluate second, because true or anything is true, so this comes out to be ABC. Students, tell me what will be the output of this quickly. First is false. False or anything, I cannot determine the result, I need to evaluate this, so this comes out 1, 2, 3. Yes, similarly logical NOT operator is there. True of the operand is false, and false, if the operand is false, it returns true. So if ABC is there, it returns false. If set is there, it returns true. Okay, so this ABC, which is non-empty sequence, is taken as is taken as true, so it returns false. Will be result of the outcome will be true. Okay. Any clarification required about it? So we will move to the next category. If there is any doubt, just put in the chat box, chat window. Otherwise, we will move to the next category of operator. They are known as Meher Singhla is asking, sir, are all empty are false? Yes, all empty are taken as false. Whether it is empty dictionary, empty sequences, empty dictionary, empty tuple, empty list, that taken as false. Empty values, they are taken as false. Yes, Meher, empty values are taken as false. Any other doubt? Any other doubt, anyone? So let's move with the next category of operators. They are known as bitwise operators. They are known as bitwise operators. They are used to do the meat manipulations in the operands. So the following operators are available: bitwise not, the sign is tilde; bitwise left shift operator, two less than sign. Remember, this is a token. There should not be a space between these two. Right shift operator, this is two greater than caret sign, bitwise or pipe sign. Now in this case, their symbols, they are same as that of C. In C also we used tilde. In C language also we used tilde for bitwise not. In C language also we used left shift as this and right shift as this. We used this in shift and we used pi for it and we used caret for it. So these symbols, they are same as that of C language in this category. In logical category, we seen that they are different from that of C, but now they are the same here. So look at the important rules about bitwise operator. Bitwise operator, they operate on the individual bit of operand and they are used for bit manipulations. They can be applied on operands. The operands of bitwise operators can be of integer type only. Bitwise and bitwise OR operator operates on the individual bits according to truth table. That's why if we do, suppose 3, 2 and 3, so what will be the result? It comes out to be 2. How come it comes out to be 2? Because 2 in binary is 0000010. This is 2, and 3 in binary is 11. Now they have to perform bit by bit. So if I perform 0 and 1, so this comes out to be 0. If I perform 1 and 1, so this comes out to be 1. 0 and 0, 0, 0 and 0, 0, so all zeros. So what is this value? This value is 2. That's why 2 and 3 comes out to be bitwise and 3 comes out to be 2. If I make it bitwise OR and execute it, it comes out to be 3, at 0. 0 or 1 is 1, so the overall result comes out to be 3. Is the working of is the working of 2 or 3 okay? Okay, fine. Next operator that we have here is bitwise XOR operator, and it works according to this. Tushar sir, please explain 3. What is that? Tushar, look at it. we have 2, 2 is 00010, and we have 3, which is 00011. I am performing bit by bit OR. So this is bitwise OR. So this is bitwise OR. 1 is 1. 1 or 1 is 1. 0 or 0 is 0. 0 or 0 is 0. 0 or 0 is 0. So what is this value? What is this value? What is this result? This is equal to 3. So that's why 2 or 3 comes out of 3. Am I okay, Tushar? Am I clear? Okay. So we have bitwise XOR operator. So it works according to the XOR truth table. XOR truth table. So if I start asking you, what is 2 XOR 3? What is 2 XOR 3? So you will say 0010 and 00011. 0 XOR 1 is 1. 1 XOR 1 is 0. 0, 0, 0. So the result is equal to 1. So you can try that. You can try that. So XOR is 2 XOR 3. And that comes out to be, and that comes out to be 1. So here is 1 and that came out. So this is 1 and that came out because we are applying 0. Like true and true is false. If I am getting only 1, 1, then I am getting true. True is true. If I am getting both false, it is false. So both false is false. True is false. 1 true is true. So that's why it came out to be 1. So this is XOR logic, and that's why we got 2 XOR 3 as 1. Bitwise NOT operator, very important. Bitwise NOT operator is used to one complement is, if I have a number 001, if I want to find its one complement, I will all I will negate all this. 1 converted to 0, 0 converted to 1, and 1 converted to 0 converted to 1, 0 converted to 1. So bitwise operator negates the bits. And you know, negative numbers, they are stored as, negative numbers are stored as 2's complement. 2's complement. And 2's complement is equal to 1's complement. 1's complement plus 1. So 2's complement is equal to 1's complement plus 1. So the negative number is equal to, negative number is equal to 2's complement. So 1's complement is equal to 1's complement is equal to 1's complement is equal to 2's complement minus 1. Or 2's complement is equal to the negative number. Bitwise NOT operator is equal to negative number minus 1. So what would be the tilde of 5? What would be the tilde of 5? That means 1's complement of 5. Tilde of 5 is equal to minus 5 minus 1. And that is equal to minus 6. So if I do that, so this comes out to be minus 6. This comes out to be minus 6. What is tilde of minus 6? So that comes out to be minus of minus 6 minus 1. So that comes out to be, what is this? Comes out to be 6 minus 1, and that comes out to be 5. That comes out to be 5. Okay. So is it okay? So next is left shift operator and right shift operator. So if you perform left shift and if you perform right shift, so suppose the number is 4. Suppose the number is 4. So this is number 4. When you shift it by one location in the left direction, it becomes 8. So it is equivalent to multiplication by 2. And when you shift it to the right direction by 2 bits, it is division by 4. So depending upon shifting left direction by 1 bit. So if you are shifting in left by 1 bit, it is equivalent to 2 raised to power number of bits you are shifting with and multiplication of that. And if you are shifting in right, it is equivalent to division by 2 raised to power the number of bits that you are shifting with. So this is all about. You can look at it. You can look at it. We have 4. If I shift it in right direction by 1, so I expect division by 2 because I shifted in right direction by 1. So it is division by 2. If I shift in right direction by 1, so it is multiplication by 2. So it gives me 8. It gives me 8. So bitwise operators, they are over. If there is any query, let me know. Otherwise we can proceed with next. I think better to look up when the session is over. You can mark your attendance. You are very much about attendance. You have put 2-3 messages into it. So we can move with other category of operators. Harsh says XOR operator. See Harsh, if you are putting XOR operator, so XOR operator truth table, you know, if one of them is true and other is false, you will get true. If both of them are true or both of them are false, you are going to get false. If one of them is true, you are going to get true. Okay, so this is the truth table. If one is true, you are going to get true. If both are true or both are false, you are going to get false. Now I perform 2 XOR 3. So you know what is 2. 2 is 0010 and 3 is 0011. Now bit by bit you have to apply operation. So 0 XOR 1 is 1 because 1 is 1 and other is 0. 1 XOR 1 is both of them are 0 XOR 0 is 0, 0 XOR 0 is 0. So result comes out to be 1. In this way, computation is carried out for XOR operator. Clear now? Shivam is asking, sir, explain bitwise not. So bitwise. So if you have to find bitwise not of 2, so bitwise not basically negates all the bits, and we say that it is used to find out one's complement. If you have gone through your basic course on digital electronics or computer architecture, you must have seen negative numbers, they are stored as 2's complement. So 2's complement of a number is 1's complement, is 1's complement plus 1. Or we can otherwise write that 1's complement is equal to 2's complement minus 1. So if I have to find 1's complement of 2, so what I will do is I will do minus 2 minus 1, that comes out to be minus 3. Okay. So in this way we can find out 1's complement. Then there is a right shift operator. Sarthak, if we apply right shift operator, say 2 right shifted by 2 bits. So if you do that, say 4 right shifted by 2 bits. So when you shift right by 1 bit, it is equivalent to division by 2. When you shift by another bit, it is equivalent to division by 4. So 4 right shifted by 2 bits is equivalent to 1. If you shift more number of times, you are going to get 0. You are going to get 0. Like if you shift 2 right shifted by 2 bits, you are going to get 0 because you are keep on shifting zeros. So if I shift 0, 1, 0 by 1 bit, but if I shift more, so 0, 0. 0. So this is going to become 0. Okay, one location it becomes 1, another location now it becomes 0. Sarthak, am I clear in my right shift operation? Sarthak, is the doubt clarified or should I repeat it? Meanwhile, Vishakha sir, in left shift and right shift, Vishakha, I already explained. Suppose you have a number, say number is 4, number is 4. You know what is the binary representation of 4, so this is 000. Right shift by 1 bit, so when you right shift it by 1 bit, so it becomes this. This one has moved here, this 0 has moved here, this 0 has moved here. One more 0 added. So this is equivalent to 8. This will give you an effect that right shifting by 1 bit is equivalent to multiplication by 2. If you shift it by one more bit, then it is equivalent to multiplication by 4. So in other words, it is equivalent to multiplication by 2 raised to the number of bits that you shift with. Similarly, when you shift in left direction, it is equal to division by 2 to 1. Okay. So, any other query about these operators? Then we move ahead. So, the next category of operators is miscellaneous operators. We have other operators included clubbed into one category, and that is known as attribute reference operator, subscription operator or subscript operator, slice operator, call operator, conditional operator, lambda expressions, and assignment operator. Just look at one by one. So attribute reference operator, as you know, yesterday, some of the data objects, they have the attributes with them, associated with them, like your complex number is having attributes real and imaginary. And if you want to access those attributes, you have to make use of attribute access operator. So you have to make use of dot operator, and that is attribute access operator. So A is complex number. A here is complex number. So this is dot is attribute reference operator, attribute reference operator. So you have attributed, you have checked the attribute imaginary. So if I do that, if I execute it, so it is going to give me 2.0. And I hope that you know why it comes out to be 2.0 instead of 2. Just quickly write down on the chat why I am getting 2.0 and I am not getting 2. Why is it happening so? Just write down on the chat box why it is happening so. Shreyas says that converted to float. Yes, whatever it is, the real part and imaginary part of complex numbers, they are always stored as float. So irrespective of whether I have written 1, it will be stored as 1.0. I have written 2, it will be stored as 2.0. Now look at this. B is equal to hello. I am referring to imaginary part. Remember that string does not have any attribute associated with it. So if I do that and attribute is not there, it will give me attribute error. So as you have seen on the screen, if you try to access attribute of an object and attribute is not there, you are going to get error. And that is attribute error. This is an exception. And later on in the course, you will know how these type of exceptions are to be handled so that your program is not stuck. So the next operator is subscript operator. You have used it to access the elements of the A if you know C language. So this subscript operator is doing the same role here. It is used to access the elements of sequences or mappings. So this is used to access the element of sequence, string, tuple, list, or mapping, which is dictionary. So if you are accessing element of a sequence, you have to give the index number of the element that you want to access to. And the index, you know, that starts with 0. So if there are 5 number of objects in a sequence, then its valid index goes from 0 to 4. And if it is mapping, then it has to be the name of the key that you want to access. Okay, am I clear? So tell me what will be the outcome of 2, 3, 4, 5. First tell me what is the type of A. What is type of A? Very quickly, I am looking for the same names on my chat box, and I expect all of you to write yes, yes, it is tuple. And can you tell me that if I enclose it within now, what is the type? Yes, Shiva, it is tuple. Now, if I enclose it, Bhavya, no, it is not list. It is still tuple because it is enclosed within curly. It is enclosed within circular brackets, parentheses. And if I access, it gives me 3. Yes, it is tuple. It gives me 3. Reason being is I am accessing the second element index. This is index 0. This is index 1. So I am accessing A1. Is second element, so that gives me 3. If you are using negative, it from the end. So if you use minus 1. So it is the last element. So if you do it like this, so this will give you 5. So you can the remember it is overflow. This is 0. This is 1. This is 2. This is 3. But I started trying to access A4. Valid indices are 0 to 3. Yes, index out of an action because index is going out of the range. Similarly, when you are giving minus 5, so when you are giving minus 5, again index error is to be there because this is minus 1. This is minus 2, this is minus 3, this is minus 4. So when I am giving minus 5, so it will give me error. It will give me index error. So it is still minus 4. If I start doing minus 4, tell me the output. If I give minus 4, what will be the output? Then it is the first element. Then it is the first element 2. Where is it? No Jadeep, no Khushi, there is no 1 in the list. So when I give minus 4, this gives 2, the first element. The last is minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, the first element. I have given B, A is 12, 17, M. This is a dictionary. Now I am referring to the dictionary with a key. So what is the output? Output is the value of L, 17 will come here. What is BA? I am accessing the dictionary, but with a key which is not present. So what will be there? So this will give me key error. Key error. Key error says key is not there in your dictionary. Okay. So look at another operator, which is known as slice operator. You can slice. You can select the range of items in your object of sequence type. The syntax of the slice operator is you have to write down object, start, stop, and stride. Stride is same as the step that you have discussed in the range type. So stride is the jumps. Okay. For example, if there is A, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, we have given the expression 1, 6, and 2. So it starts with index 1. It starts with index 1. Take strides of 2 means skip one object and add next object. So 2 is selected. 4 is selected. Item would be 2, 4, and 6. Okay. So look at the slice operator. Slice operator returns the element starting from the index till the index, excluding the item at the index, stop, skipping stride minus 1 items. Skipping stride minus 1 items. So, and this is computed by this rule 1 plus start plus n into stride. So this we have already discussed while we done with the range. So similar is the stride. Call operator is used to call functions and used to call methods. So once you start doing your functions and methods, this operator will be discussed with you in detail. Conditional operator is like your ternary operator available in C. So the syntax of conditional operator is you have to write expression 1 followed by if, followed by expression, followed by else, followed by expression 2. Expression is evaluated. If it comes to be false, expression 2 will be evaluated. So look at it. A is equal to 10. A is equal to 10. So firstly, this expression is evaluated. This expression is evaluated. This expression is evaluated. A mod 2 comes out to be 10 mod 2 comes out to be 0. Since it comes out to be false, this will not be evaluated and expression 2 will be evaluated, which comes out to be even. So the result is even. Similarly, if A is 11, so A mod 2 comes out to be 1, which is true. So if it is true, odd will get evaluated. Lambda operator is used for creating anonymous functions like your inline functions. So this will again be covered when your functions will be covered. And assignment operator. Day before yesterday we discussed assignment in Python is your statement. Assignment is a statement, but in Python 3.8 this operator is added, and this is walrus operator. This is the assignment operator. Okay, so this is walrus operator. This is assignment operator. So assignment in Python is a statement. It is not operator. But sometimes you need name few sub expressions, the result of evaluation of the is really in version 3.8 web is Python enhancement proposal. So PEP 572 introduced this assignment operator, which is known as walrus operator, and its purpose is to give the name to the sub expression. Look at these statements. A is equal to 2 into 3, 5, 6, 4, and B is equal to 2 into 3, 5 into 6, 4 more. So 2 into 3, we say that they have common sub expression. So we should not evaluate them again and again. But if I am not able to give name to the result of evaluation of sub expression, I cannot use it in the sub expression. That's why this purpose of walrus. So when you use walrus operator, which is not nothing but an assignment operator, now you written t is assigned 2 into 3 plus 5 into 6. So 2 into 3 plus 5 into 6 is computed and is assigned to t. Remember, previous statement was a statement. Statement cannot come within a statement. A statement cannot come in a statement. So it is not possible to write any value here. So now it is possible. So sub expression is evaluated, assigned e, and then in the second we are using e, we are computing it. So this is exceptions are that walrus operator cannot be used as expression in few places and it requires parenthesization. There are few cases like expression statement cannot have unparenthesized form of assignment expression. And there are few more exceptions. I would like only to focus on the first one. But before that, I show you the usage of the walrus operator. Here, this is if statement we have not yet discussed. We will discuss in the next session. But if it requires expression here, and in expression, assignment statement, it cannot come in place of. So if you start doing this, you are going to get syntax error in Python. This works in C, but this doesn't work in Python till now. In version 3.8, it has been allowed, and now you can make it as a walrus operator. It is assignment operator, but given a second name, walrus operator. And once you do it, this is okay. It prints hi. And if I also want to check what is the value that A got, so this says hi and A got value 3. So here I am assigning value to A 3, and simultaneously I am asking it to participate as an expression and get evaluated. Look at it. A walrus operator 3 plus 2. So if you start doing it, so this will give you the syntax error. Being is the purpose of introducing walrus operator in Python 3.8 is not to make assignment statement deprecated. It is not to remove the assignment statement. It has a different meaning. It has to be used as a sub expression for the usage of the replacement of sub expressions. So if you start using assignment walrus operator instead of assignment, then it will give you error. It does not allow you to do that. In that case, if you parenthesize it, it thinks that it is participating as a sub expression, and then if you evaluate it, it will be allowed to you. So writing a walrus operator 3 plus 2 is not allowed, because in expression statement you cannot use. This is expression statement. You cannot use walrus operator as such. If you do that, you will get error. But if you parenthesize it, you walrus to get the value to participate in an expression, and I am going to use value of A, and then it will allow you to do that. Similar is here. A is equal to B walrus operator 3. If you try to do that, you cannot. But if you try, and if you say that I am going to use it and I will require B store the result of evaluation of sub expression, Python will allow you to do that, and it will allow you to do that, and it will also give the value of A and B as 3. B will get value 3. I can also print value of A. I can print value of A. So this would be 3 and 3. So just to reiterate, I'll tell you what is happening in this statement. in this statement, this is even allowed, but this is complete statement. There is no operator involved. These are chaining of assignment statements, but now I am involving an operator, which is walrus operator. So firstly, this will be evaluated. 3 is assigned to B, and then the outcome of the evaluation of expression is assigned to A. So both A and B will get value 3, but that is using the walrus operator. So these miscellaneous operators will have these precedence, and call operator, slice operator, subscript operator, attributance operator, conditional operator, lambda we have not yet discussed, walrus I have already touched upon. And this is the combined test for the entire operators. This precedence chart. You can practice what I have already learned. If you have few doubts, I'll be happy to take those. And then we can do few things, and then we will move ahead with the statements in our next session. So just to wind up our expressions and operators, if you have few doubts, I'll be happy to quickly take those, and then we will move ahead with these. Any doubt about it? Okay, look at what is the outcome of this first. Tell me the outcome of this first. A is 5 raised to power minus 2. So this is equivalent to 1 upon 25. So this comes out to be float. This comes out to be float. And second is minus 2 raised to power 5. So what is the second? What is the second comes out to be? So this comes out to be integer. So float and int. Yes. So what will be the outcome of 0 raised to power minus 2? So if I do 0 raised to power minus 2, so this comes out to be 1. Kushigarh, no. Comes out to be 0. No. It comes out to be 0 error. 1 upon 0 leads to error, and that is 0 division error that I already told you. If the first operand is 0, the second operand cannot be negative number. It is minus 2 raised to power 0. If minus 2 raised to power 0 is there, it always comes out to be 1. What comes to be 3 raised to power 2 raised to power 3? Tell me in the chat window how it will be interpreted. 3 raised to power 2 raised to power 3. So this would be, tell me, parenthesize it. Parenthesize this expression. 3 raised to power 2 raised to power 3. Yes, Shrey, this is right. This is parenthesized in the way, correct way that you have written. What will be the outcome of this? Tell me how it will be interpreted. Don't use your interpreters to tell the result. How it will be interpreted? 1 plus 2j raised to power 0. How it will be interpreted? Tell me. So this will be interpreted as exponent operator is having more precedence. So this will be interpreted as like this. And when the one operator is complex, another operator is integer, they will get converted to complex. So this will become 0 plus 2j raised to power 0 plus 0j. 0j. And this will result in 1 plus anything raised to power 0 comes out to be 1. So this will come out to be 1 plus 0j. This will come out to be 2 plus 0j. That's what I expect. So 2 plus 0j, Aman Goyal, no, 2, it's not correct. It is 2 plus complex. We have this one number is 3, walrus, the number is complex. Already explained how it, 2j is firstly converted to 0 plus 2j, 0 is converted to 0 plus 0j. Result of 0 plus 2j power 0 plus 0j comes out to be 1 plus 0j, and then it is added, and then it is added. So this is 1 plus 0j also. And the result comes out to be 2 plus 0j. Tell me what will be the outcome of this 1 plus 2j raised to power 0. So it comes out to be 1 plus 0j. Yes, we have already discussed a few times. What is minus 27 raised to 1p? And what is, tell me the type quickly. You need not compute, you have to only tell me the types. You need not compute. Tamanna, there are two outputs, Tushar. There are two outputs, not only one, two. There are two types that I want to print. What is the output? Mesh, Mayank, integer, complex. So let's execute it. Minus negative number raised to power fraction leads to negative number raised to power leads to your complex number, and negative of 27 leads to floating point number. Can anybody tell me what is the rule? The rule is that if one of the operand is floating point, the other gets converted to floating point. This is the rule. So since this is 0.33, so firstly 27 gets converted to 27.0, then the power is computed and comes out to be class float. And in this case, negative raised to power fraction or float, outcome of this, what is outcome of this? What is outcome of dictionary being multiplied by 2? This gives you type error. It is not allowed. What is multiplication with floating point number? Not allowed. What is ABC into 0? If you multiply it with 0, you are going to get empty sequence. Yes, Shreya. This is empty sequence. That's why not printed. If I write it like this, so it will give me empty sequence. It will give me sense. Okay. Have to write a Python test program. Leave is divisible by 4 and by 100, or it will be 100. Code that we have. Input. Look, so the year. Then I am using conditional operators. Is conditional operator operation is again better. This is expression 2. This condition print function and phone call is it depending on it evaluates to true or false, either this we executed or this will be executed. So when I give 2000, it will year comes out to be, and year mode 100 mode is not equal to 0 comes out to be false to be true, that this to be executed. What is that? If you put 2000, so this comes, okay, what is the issue, Tushar? Empty, what is empty? You want to check whether number is even or not. So even number converted into int, check whether mode is equal to 0. If it is equal to 0, print that it is even. If it is not equal to 0, print that it is odd. If I execute it, say 14 is even. If I execute it, say 15 is odd. You want to check whether number is even or odd, but you do not want to use the modulus operator. So the other way to check whether number is even or odd is to check the last bit of the number. Even numbers have their last bit as 0, odd numbers have their last bit as 1. So that's what we are checking here. If the number and 1, that means if the last bit of the number is equal to 0, the number is even, otherwise the number is odd. So let's run it 12. 12 is even. Let's run it. 15. 15 is odd. So that's odd. Similarly, we want to check whether number exists in a given list or not. So I can the list, I have evaluated, I want this number using member structure in, and I'm running it. So the list that are in the list or not before, so it says that 5, say 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 is not in the list. Okay, that's all about operators and expressions from my side. You have a quick, quickly let me know, otherwise we can wind up with the session. Dr. Puneet, we can meet up.
Yes sir.
Dr. Puneet, am I audible?
Yes sir. So
yes, kindly schedule the next, and
if you have any query,
yeah, Dr. Puneet, kindly schedule the next class at 1 o'clock.
Yes sir.
The next class, kindly schedule it at 1 o'clock. 1 o'clock.
Okay. So next class will be 1 o'clock. Yes. So all the participants are required to join sharply by 12:45. And if you have any queries regarding this session, you can type it in the chat box, or you can discuss the queries in the next session also. So I think we can wind up now.
Thank you. Thank you. Now. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Ajay.
Thank you, Dr. Magesh. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And one more thing to announce for the participants is that you need to fill the attendance sheet. You all need to fill the attendance sheet by 12:30. So, please try to complete this. If you are having any doubt about the attendance marking or attendance sheet, you may share it in the text box. I am available.
Okay, Mukesh sir, can I leave?
Yes ma'am, you may leave.
I'll join, I'll join later on.